سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the ni'ma of iman, for blessing us and making us of the ummah of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the ummah of the Holy Quran. We thank him for all his favors. We thank him for this opportunity to be here in this masjid for no worldly purpose, aim or gain, but to speak about him, Jalla Jalaluhu, and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and for our specific purpose and intent here today, to speak about some of the giants of this ummah of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Men whom we may have not, or men whom we may not have met, but whom we love with all our hearts. Men whom we wish we had met, and we hope that had we lived in that time, we would have stood with them in those ranks of companions of the beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They lived in that time of revelation. They lived in his company. And it must have been awe-inspiring. It must have been beautiful, unlike any company that we could ever imagine. However, it was also a trying period, the start of the deen of Islam and the start of its presentation. So along with all the beauty that they experienced from the company of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the atmosphere of the revelation of wahi of the Holy Quran, the final revelation, they also had to endure lots of trials and tribulations. And they taught us that iman is not only a set of words and phrases. Iman is qawl and amal. Iman is word as well as action. I have a small collection of biographies in Arabic that I would have loved to have done. And I was informed by Mullah Khalil that it may be that those in attendance, not all are students of the Arabic language. So I forwarded names of the companions I would love to address. And then some basic biographies were arranged for you. They are not necessarily in the sequence that we are going to do them in. You are able to read them in a few minutes, those that you have. I've looked at them. So bear with me. Today, inshallah, I would love to address the companion with one of the shortest biographies in your list there. He's on page 35, and his name is Rabi'ah ibn Ka'b. So I knew that would happen, and I want you to see where it is, but I don't want you to read it now. I'd like you to close it now. And I want you to read it later. And I want you to share with me a few of his own words about himself and about his relationship with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and what transpired from this basic relationship. So, Rabi'ah ibn Ka'b, he said, in the Medina period, firstly, he did not have any close family. He was a member of a particular tribe, Banu Aslam. He says that when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam entered Medina, I was a young man. Kuntu fatan hadith as-sin. And I was a young man fortunate to have the nur of iman and the attraction of Islam into my heart at that time. Not like the other senior sahaba. And he says, my eyes, لما اتحلت عيناي بمرأة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, when my eyes were adorned and beautified with the vision of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam awwal maratin for the first time, ahbabtuhu hubban malaka alayya kull jarihatin min jawarihi. I immediately loved him, such a love that overtook my entire being from my very first glance. وَأُولِعْتُ بِهِ وَلَعْنِ. And I became engrossed with him. And my love for him and my time that I wanted to spend with him resulted in me not being with anyone or anything else. So there are two basic things I would love to address regarding his narrative. Number one is the way in which he spoke with himself, as you will soon hear, inshallah, the way in which he had a certain level of introspection, which we require in Ramadan, especially more so in these last few days of Ramadan. Man sama Ramadan imanan wa ihtisaban. Many translate ihtisaban as seeking reward. Whosoever fasts Ramadan with iman and seeking reward, but ihtisaban, there's no link actually to reward or pleasure of any kind. Ihtisab is linked to hasiba yahsibu, to hisab, which means accountability, reckoning, self-account. Whosoever fasts with iman and taking stock of himself, there's something in store for that person. And he had this, he would speak to himself. So what does he say here? After I saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for the first time, I loved him. Then, قُلْتُ فِي نَفْسِي ذَاتَ يَوْمٍ. I said to myself one day, لِمَا لَا تُجَرِّدُ نَفْسَكَ لِخِدْمَةِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. Why don't you free yourself for the service of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Present yourself to him. The Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was now 53 and beyond years old, Medina now, and Anas was there in Marik al-Dawah. But a young boy, I'm a bit older, present myself to him. In Radiya Bik, he's telling himself, if the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is pleased with you, you will enjoy his company even more, and you may even win his love. You love him. He's telling himself, you love him, Ya Rabi'ah. Present yourself to him. If he's pleased with you, you may enjoy his company even more, and you may even gain wafuzta bihubbihi. Not only that, you will then gain khayra in dunya wal akhirah. The best of this dunya, company of Rasulullah. And by being in his servants, you definitely get the best in the akhirah too. So he says, after I came to this realization, مَا لَبِثْتُ. I did not hesitate. I did not wait long, and I presented myself to him. وَرَجَوْتُهُ أَنْ يَقْبَلَنِي فِي خِدْمَتِي. I was hoping that he accepts me in his service. فَلَمْ يُخَيِّبْ رَجَائِي. He did not disappoint me. صلى الله عليه وسلم. وَرَضِيَ بِي أَنْ أَكُونَ خَالِبًا لَهُ. فَصِرْتُ. What beautiful phrase, what beautiful words he says. He says, صِرْتُ مُنْذُ ذَلِكَ الْيَوْمِ أَلْزَمَ لِلنَّبِيِّ الْكَرِيمِ بِالْبِلِّهِ. I clung more to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم from that day. I clung more to him than his shadow. أَسِيرُ مَعَهُ أَيْنَمَا سَرَى. I move with him wherever he moves. وَأَدُورُ فِي فَلَكِهِ كَيْفَ مَا دَارُ. And I rotate his orbit wherever he rotates. Falak. Wherever he is, I am. فَمَا رَمَى بِطَرْفِهِ مَرَّةً نَحْوِ إِلَّا مَثُلْتُ وَاضِحًا. He didn't even throw his glance in my direction, except I stood up ready for duty. وَمَا تَشَوَّفَ لِحَاجٍ مِنْ حَاجَاتِ إِلَّا وَجَدَنِي مُسْرِعًا فِي قَضَائِهَا. And he did not utter any particular need, except that he would find me hastening to fulfill this need. Now he says, I used to serve him in the daytime, the whole day I'm there with him, the entire day. كُنْتُ أَخْدِمُهُ نَهَارًا كُلًّا. فَإِذَا قَضَى النَّهَارُ, when the day is over, وَصَلَّى الْعِشَاء الْأَخِيرَ, when he performs Isha, he goes to his home, he goes to his house, and I leave. But then, after the second day, third day, I leave, and I think to myself, I speak to myself again. Speaking to himself. إِلَىٰ أَيْنَ تَمْضِي يَا رَبِيعَ. Where are you going to, Ya Rabi'ah? He tells himself, فَلَعَلَّهَا تَعْلُمُ لِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ حَاجَةٌ بِاللَّيْلِ. What if Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has a need at night? So what did I do? And you're not there, so he said, what I did? أَجْلِسُ عَلَىٰ بَابِي ولا أتحول عن عتبة بيتي. I didn't lift. I was going to Yulia, where he was going to. He did not have a home for himself. I would go to Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's door, and I would spend the entire night by his doorstep. The entire night by his doorstep. Not knocking, just waiting in case he comes out and he has a dinner. So now a few things happened. He says, at night I would sit, and I would doze off, and then what would wake me up? The voice of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not calling for any dunya needs, no. The voice of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam reciting at night. I would hear him recite al-Fatiha at times. I would hear him sometimes say, Sami'a Allahu liman hamida. And when I know he's in prayer, I would be calm, because if he's in prayer, he would not be concerned about any dunya need. I would leave him be. Okay? So this would go on for some time. So that's number one. His level of self-consciousness. And where he is, and where he wants to be. And the moment he realizes some khair, some good in some action, he did not hesitate to go and do it. Right? Okay. Section 2. He mentioned something, some characteristic of our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is very, very important. But through it, we get to the second lesson from Rabi'ah. What is the characteristic of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would not want people to go out of their way for him without him being able to return the favor and do good. He did not expect anything from anyone, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Didn't he sweep in his own home? Didn't he mend his own clothes? Didn't he share as much? Wasn't he more generous than a beautiful breeze, especially in the days of Ramadan? So Rabi'ah says, وَقَدْ كَانَ مِنْ عَادَةِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ أَنَّهُ مَا صَنَعَ لَهُ أَحَدٌ مَعْرُوفًا إِلَّا أَحَبَّ أَنْ يُجَازِيَهُ عَلَيْهِ بِمَا هُوَ أَجَلُّ مِنْهُ. It was the habit of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم that no one did any good for him except that he loved to repay that person with something better than what that person initially did. So, وَقَدْ أَحَبَّ أَنْ يُجَازِيَنِي عَلَى خِدْمَةِ لَهُ. I sensed some anxiousness from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Realizing he wants to repay me for my service. And what happened? I would go to him every day. Is it not? But he says here, أَقْبَلَ عَلَيَّ ذَاتَ يَوْمَ. Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to me one day and said, Ya Rabi'ah ibn Ka'b, O Rabi'ah. I responded, Labbaik, Ya Rasulullah wa sa'atayk. The Nabi said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Salmi shay'an u'ti'i lak. Ask me for anything, I will give you. Ask me, I will give you. He then says, he realizes the type of person he was. Not just popping or saying anything that pops up into his head. He was a man of reflection, as we can already see. He says, Rawaytu khalila. I pondered for a while. Now I'm sitting, the Messenger is waiting for the answer. I'm pondering for a while. ثُمَّ قُلْتُ. I said to him, صلى الله عليه وسلم, أَمْهِلْنِي يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. Give me some more time, يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. لِأَبْضُرَ فِي مَا أَطْلُبُهُ مِنْكَ. So that I can make a good decision regarding what you are requesting from me. ثُمَّ أُعْلِمَتْ. Then I'll inform you. And the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم said, لَا بَأْسَ عَلَيْكَ. No problem. Don't worry. Take your time. Okay? So now he gives you a small window as to his situation. He says, كُنْتُ يَوْمَ إِذِنْ شَابًا فَقِيرًا. At the time, when this came to me, I wasn't of means, I was a poor boy. لَا أَهْلَ لِي. I had no family. وَلَا مَالَ لِي. I had no wealth. وَلَا سَكَنْ. I had no dwelling of my own. وَإِنَّمَا كُنْتُ آوِي إِلَى صُفَّةِ الْمَسْجِدِ. I used to go there to the Sufa of Masjid al-Nabawi, مَعَ أَمْثَالِ فُقَرَاءِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ, with others like me of the poor of the Muslims. And the people used to call us the Duyuful Islam, the guests of Islam. Now this section here, I want to highlight something. We have to work for this dunya. We have to work and go out into the world, but as believers, we understand and remind ourselves that our priority is working for the Akhirah. The only reason why I'm working for a better salary is so that when I put my head on the musalla, or when I stand in prayer, I am contented that I have enough for my worldly means so I can fully focus on my prayer. That's why I work. To be seen to and comfortable enough so that my ibadah can be of a good quality. Understand that point? So I work, but my focus is still akhirah. But another point we're going to see is this, inshallah, in Rabi'ah's narrative, is that if we put the akhirah above everything else, Allah will still give us dunya. And dunya may even come after us, without us even seeking or asking for it. So he says, I was of those in Suffa. When Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to receive a sadaqah, he would send the entire sadaqah to us. Would he never accept the sadaqah? You knew that, right? He would accept the hadiyah, a gift. When a gift comes to him, he would take of it and give the remaining of the gift to us, of Suffa. So he says, I'm thinking of my situation. فَحَدَّثَتْنِي نَفْسِي. I'm speaking to myself, and I'm thinking, أَنْ أَطْلُبَ مِنَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ شَيْءٍ مِنْ خَيْرِ الدُّنْيَا. I'm thinking, maybe I should ask him to organize me something of the good of this dunya. أَغْتَنِي بِهِ مِنْ فَقْرٍ. And I can get rid of this poverty. وَأَرْضُكَ الْآخِرِ. I can become like the others. ذَا مَالٍ وَزَوْجٍ وَوَلَدٍ. I can have some wealth, I can have a wife and some children, establish myself. لَكِنِّي. But he says, the moment that thought came to my mind, I pulled back. And then I said to myself, تَبَّلْ لَكْ. What's wrong with you, Ya Rabi'ah? إِنَّ الدُّنْيَا زَائِرَةً. This dunya is temporary. فَانِيَا. It's going to perish. وَإِنَّ لَكَ فِيهَا رِزْقًا كَافِرًا. And you get sustenance. كَفَرَ اللَّهُ. Allah sees to your sustenance. فَلَا بُدَّ أَنْ يَأْتِيَكَ. It will come to you, whatever sustenance is decreed for you. وَالرَّسُولُ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فِي مَنْزِلَةٍ عِنْدَ رَبِّي. And the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم has a prized position by Allah. لَا يُرَدُّ لَهُ مَعَهَا طَلَبٌ. No request is refused in the position that he has by Allah. فَاطْلُبْ مِنْهُ أَنْ يَسْأَلَ اللَّهَ لَكَ مِنْ فَضْلِ الْآخِرَةِ. So seek from him that he requests from Allah to grant you from the bounty of the Akhirah instead. He says, the moment I thought of this, the moment this realization came to my heart, طَابَتْ نَفْسِي. I felt contented. I forgot the dunya. وَاسْتَرَاحَتْ لَهُ. And I became calm and relaxed. So then I came to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. جِئْتُ إِلَيْهِ. He says, Nabi Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم was busy with others. But the moment I stepped in, this was Nabi's character. He wanted to repay Rabi'ah. The moment he saw Rabi'ah, the first thing he does, he says, مَا تَقُولُ يَا رَبِيعَةَ. What do you say, يَا رَبِيعَةَ? Have you made up your mind? And Rabi'ah says, Ya Rasulullah, أسألك أن تدعو. يا الله تعالى أن يجعلني رفيقا لك في الجنة. I ask you to pray for me that Allah makes me a companion of yours in Jannah. فقال نبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, من أوصاك بذلك؟ Who advised you to say this? He said, لا والله ما أوصاني بأحد. No one advised me to say this. ولكنك قلت لي. When you said to me, ask me, I will give you. I spoke to myself and I firstly thought that I should ask you something for this dunya. But then I came to realize that what is better for me is what? إثار الباقية على الفانية. Is to give preference over the or give preference to the eternal over the temporary. فَسَأَلْتُكَ أَنْ تَدَعُوَ اللَّهَ لِي يَعْنَ كُونَ رَفِيقُكَ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. So therefore I asked him for this. He now says, unexpected request. He says, صَمَتَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ طَوِيلًا. Nabi Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم remained silent for a long while. Silent. Then he raised his head and he said, أَوَلَّيْهُ ذَلِكَ يَا رَبِيعًا. Any other requests, يَا رَبِيعًا? Anything else you want? He says, كَلَّا يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. Never know, يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. مَا أَعْدِلُ بِمَا سَأَلْتُكَ شَيْئًا. There's nothing that can compete to my request. This is the ultimate that I want. فقال and he said to us, إذن أعني على نفسك بكثرة السجود. Help me to help you by increasing in your sujood, increasing in your sajda. Make more sujood. He says, فَجَعَلْتُ أَدْعَبُ فِي الْعِبَادَةِ. I started intensifying my worship, increasing my worship. I'm in his service, and every free moment I make extra two rak'ah. I'm in his service, and whenever I can, I make more salah. Why? Because I know he's going to make dua, and I know his words are important. He's going to make dua, but with dua, I have to make effort. I can't just ask, I have to make effort. لِأَحْظَى بِمُرَافَقَةِ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فِي الْجَنَّةِ كَمَا حُزِيْتُ بِخِدْمَتِهِ وَصُحْبَتِهِ فِي الدُّنْيَا. So that I may be blessed with his company in Jannah, like I was now blessed with his company and his service in the dunya. A small pause. Hadith comes to mind of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that our actions will not result in our entry to paradise. Our actions will not result in our entry to paradise. He said this to the companions and they asked him, even your actions, Ya Rasulullah, that are on such a level, even your actions will not result in your entry into paradise. So what will result in our entry and what's the use of the actions? He then said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the only way I will enter is يَتَغَمَّدَنِي اللَّهُ بِرَحْمَةٍ مِنْهُ وَفَضْلٍ, is if Allah encompasses me in His grace and His mercy. The purpose for the action is to become deserving of Allah's mercy and His grace. If I am worshipping for Jannah, Jannah is a creation of Allah. If I am worshipping or abstaining from certain things haram, because I don't want Jahannam, Jahannam is a creation. Rabi'ah al-Awliya also said, oh Allah, if I am worshipping you for Jannah, then deprive me of it. And if I am worshipping you because I fear Jahannam, then fling me into it. But if I am worshipping you for your pleasure, then grant me whatever you wish to grant me. Because either way it comes from you. So, the sujood was not simply for the company or Jannah itself. The sujood was to draw rahmah. The sujood was to draw Allah's grace to help that unique prayer and request by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that's the second section. Of all that he could ask, he was asking for this. But now, some things are going to happen. Because he gave priority to Akhirah. He could have asked for anything. And then Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is mustajab da'wah. His dunya could have been sorted and seen to. But he gave preference to the suhbah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Akhirah. So he says, ثُمَّ إِنَّهُ لَمْ يَقْضِ عَلَى ذَلِكَ وَقْتٌ طَوِيلٌ حَتَّى نَادَانِي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَقَالَ. He says, it wasn't even a long time that passed, and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called me. Now again, before I tell you what the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, this is Medina. Badr was taking place. We must see what period of time this was. What was happening there? Masjid al-Nabawi was being built, establishment of the capital of Islam, lots of things were happening, but out of all the happenings, out of all these people, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, by this particular request here and question, had concern for him in particular. Can you imagine how pleased that must have made him? Or rather, can you imagine what type of man Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was? Out of all it was happening there. Plus there were Muhajirun and there were Ansar. Plus there were Jews also in Medina. Plus there were Mawathiq and tribal issues both in Khazraj, and there were the relationship between them and the Jews themselves. Lots of issues. But here he sees Rabi'ah and he calls him. He calls him. Young, maturing man. And he says to him, look at the question. He says to him, ألا تتزوج يا ربيعة؟ Don't you have any intention to get married يا ربيعة؟ Out of all the things you have asked, صلى الله عليه وسلم. He then says, look at his answer. He said, ما أحب أن يشغلني شيء عن خدمتك يا رسول الله. صلى الله عليه وسلم. I do not wish, or I will not like that anything occupies me from your service, يا رسول الله. He gives preference to Rasulullah's service over marriage. And then also he adds, also the reality of the situation is this, ليس عندي ما أمر به زوجة. I don't have anything sufficient as a mother for any wife. ولا ما أقيم حياتها علي. I needed to have anything to be to do something to نفقها. فسكت. And I left. A second occasion he calls me again as if Nabi was worried about his condition. He was serving the Nabi. The Nabi wants him to see. The Nabi wants to see him progress. Nabi calls him again, asks him the same question, and he responds with the same answer, but now something happens. Who is he? He's the man of reflection, Rabi'ah. So he says, after Rasulullah asks me the same question the second time, I find myself speaking to myself again, as you normally did before. He says, خلوت إلى نفسي نديت على ما كأهلكيتك. The way I responded. وقلت, I said, ويحك يا ربيع, what's wrong with you يا ربيع؟ والله إن النبي لا أعلم منك بما يصلح لك في دينك ودنياك. He said, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم knows best what is good for you for your deen and your dunya. وأعرف منك بما عندك. And he knows best what your potential is. He's speaking to himself. You might not know, but the Nabi asking you this means something. Right? So he says, wallahi, if you were to ask me again, I will answer differently. Okay? And it so happened, the Nabi asked him again, Allah tatazawwaj ya Rabi'ah, what do you want? You interested to get married ya Rabi'ah? And he says, bala ya Rasulullah, most certainly, I'm interested. But the reality is this, man yuzawwijni, who will get me married? Wa ana kama ta'lam, and I am like you know I am. I am like you know. Nabi Sallam said, look, look at Nabi Sallam's foresight and resourcefulness. He says, go to ila Ali Fulan, intalib ila Ali Fulan, go to a particular family. Wa kullahum, and tell them, inna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ya'murukum an tuzawwijuni fatatakum fulana. Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent me and he has given me the message to tell you to get me married to your daughter so and so. The Nabi sends me with this message. So now he says, I am baffled now. I don't know what to do. And he says, I go to them ala istihya, full counter, with lots of shyness. But I'm telling myself, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said these words, I simply have to convey. That's my amana. So they open the door. And I said to them, I don't know the people. I don't know the people. I said to them, Inna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam arsalani ilaykum. He sent me to you. You tuzawwijuni fatatakum fulana. That you marry, get me married to your daughter so and so. They said, fulana so and so. Specify the name. He said, na'am. He hasn't seen the girl, nothing. You know what they responded with? The Nabi knew who the people were in his time, and he knew their potential, and he knew these good people, and he knew all that they needed was a platform to show their goodness. You know how they responded? Marhaban bi Rasulillah, wa marhaban bi Rasuli Rasulillah. Welcome to Rasulullah, and welcome to the messenger of Rasulullah. Wallahi la yarji'u Rasulullah Rasulillah illa bihajati. By Allah, the messenger of the messenger of Allah will not return except with what he came for. وَأَعْقَدُوا لِي عَلَيْهَا, and they did an engagement for me with her. So now he says, I hasten back to Rasul. My mind is reeling. My life changes like this. But now I go back to Rasulullah. Ya Rasulullah. He says, لَقَدْ جِئْتُ مِنْ عِنْدِ خَيْرِ بَيْتِ, I have come to you from the best house in Medina. صَدَّقُونِ, they believe me. وَرَحَبُوا بِي, and they welcome me. وَأَعْقَدُوا لِي عَلَى الَّتِي, and they got me engaged to their daughter just like that. But now there's another issue, Ya Rasulullah. مِنْ أَيْنَ آتِيهِمْ بِالْمَهْرِ, what must I do with the maskari, the dowry? So now look, he had no family, but he was from a tribe. But who? أَسْلَمْ, yes. فَاسْتَدْعَى الرَّسُولُ صلى الله عليه وسلم بُرَيْجَةَ بْنَ الْخَصِيمِ. Now he said, you sit here. You have a lot to think about now. He tells him, you wait, you sit here. And he sent for another Sahabi, Buraida. Buraida, كَانَ سَيِّدَتْ مِنْ سَادَاتِ قَوْمِي بَنِي أَسْلَمْ. So Rabi'ah says, that Buraida was one of the honorables, the chiefs of my tribe, Banu Aslam. Now Hurayda comes and he sits next to me in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to Hurayda, Rabi'ah was nanawat in Tahaban. He says, this boy is from your tribe. This has happened, he's engaged, he's going to get married, he's in need. You see to it that he has a small amount of gold that you want to give him for his mahar for that lady. Nawat is the word used for a dekbet. A dekbet. This is a piece of gold equal to the weight of a dekbet. Something small. And now he says, the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says this to the man. The man stands up and goes and comes back. فَجَمَعُوا هَذِي. They gathered it for me. I had nothing. I was sleeping in the masjid the other day. I just served Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. I asked him, not for dunya, I asked him for akhirah. But look at this now. They bring me this. So the Nabi says, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, كِرَهَا بِهَا إِلَيْهِ. Go with this to them. And tell them that this is the sadaq for your daughter. The dowry for your daughter. So I go with this. And I give it to them. فَقَبِلُوهُ. They accepted it. وَرَضُوهُ. They were pleased with it. More than that, they said, كَثِيرٌ طَيِّبٌ. It's a lot and it's very good. He says, I go back to Rasulullah and I say to him, مَا رَأَيْتُ قَوْمًا قَطُّ أَكْرَمَ مِنْهُمْ. I have not seen people more generous and more noble than those people who sit between Rasulullah. لَقَدْ رَضُوا مَا أَعْطَيْتُمْ. They were pleased with what I gave them. عَلَى قِلَّتِهِ. Despite how little it was, وَقَالُوا كَثِيرٌ طَيِّبٌ. And they said, it's a lot and it's beautiful. Now, last problem. What's the last problem? You're going to have the nikah, Ya Rasulullah, but I would like to have a walima. A small reception. مِنْ أَيْنَ لِي مَا أُولِمُ بِهِ. What can I, where will I get that which will be sufficient for a walima? Ya Rasulullah. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said to Burayda, who's Burayda? The chief of the tribe. Gather for him the amount required for the purchase of a goat. And then buy him the goat. He says, they came and they brought me kamshan azeeman samina, a big, grand, fat goat. Then Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam sent me, he said, he looks at me, Rabi'ah, he says, idhab ila Aisha. Go to your mother Aisha, our mother, Umm al-Mu'mineen, radiallahu anha wa Allah. And then you tell her to give you whatever barley she has in the house, min al-sha'ir in the house. I came to her and I told her what Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says. She gave him and then she said something. She says, at the end after giving, she says, wallahi ma indaha ta'am ghayru. All that I give you is all the food that we currently have in the house. Nothing else, take it all. He says, I go with this barley, and I go with the big ram, the goat, to my future in-laws. And I say, this is what we want. Can we make something for your reception? They tell me, the barley given to us, we'll make some bread. You, with your people, you see to the goat. So he says, I take the goat, and people, ana wa nasu min aslam, people from my tribe. Now he's a tribal man now. He was alone there in the masjid again, service. Now his tribesmen, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam showed him honor. Everything changed for him overnight. The tribesmen are all around him now. And they helped him. He says, Father Bahnaw, we slaughtered this goat together, me and my tribesmen. وَسَلَخْنَا and we skinned it. وَطَبَخْنَا and we cooked it. فَأَصْبَحَ عِنْدَنَا خُبْزٌ وَلَحْمٌ. So we had some meat and we had some bread. And then the cherry on top. I دعوت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى وليمتي فأجاب دعوتي. I invited رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم to my reception and he responded to my reception. I made him the guest of honor. Things changed. Okay? Request for Akhirah. Got dunya to come. But that's not the end. Last piece. And Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم thought of everything for him. And then Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, reminded him not to speak out of his own, ma yantiqu an al-hawa. Did not speak out of what? His own desire. Meaning, whatever came via Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for this young man, Rabi'ah, came from Allah jalla jalla. Because his hum was not dunya. His hum was akhirah. His hum is concern. And so, because he made his hum and his concern, service of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and wanting the best of Akhirah, Allah suffices for any whom any needs and concerns that he may have had for dunya. So last but in no way least, he had a wife now. He had lovely in-laws. He says, ثُمَّ إِنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمْ مَنَحَنِي أَرْضًا إِلَى جَانِبِ أَرْضٍ لِأَبِي بَكْرٍ رَضِي اللَّهُ عَنْهُ وَرْضَاهُ. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam arranged for me for a plot of land next to the land of Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu. I became an owner of land now. So you could farm things, you could live off the land, you could do some things. A man in his own right. So he says, فَدَخَلَتْ عَلَيَّ الدُّنْيَا. The dunya opened, the dunya entered upon me. All from that, one dua. But now what happens, he's got the best of neighbors, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Isn't it? A Siddiq? Now. But we have to live together, pass by each other. So some things may happen. And something happened between them which we learn from. But look what happened. There was no fence between their properties, dividing their property. No fence. And there were trees, palm trees. And it so happened one day, there was one palm tree that they both stood looking at and pondered. Is this now part of my plot, or is it part of your plot? Even Abu Bakr Siddiq Allah. And they had, Abu Bakr was a senior by far, and they had a conversation. And somehow in the conversation, look at his character. He does not disclose exactly what happened. He says during the conversation, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu became a bit upset with me. And uttered one word that I disliked. But the moment he uttered this word, he, Abu Bakr al-Anbu, regretted it and said something. He says, نَزَعْتُهُ أَسْمَعَنِي كَلِمَةً كَرِيْتُهَا فَلَمَّا بَدَرْتُ مِنُ الْكَلِمَةً. The moment this word came out of Abu Bakr's mouth, radiallahu anhu, the elderly man now, right? نَدِمَ عَلَيْهَا. He regretted it. وقال, يَا رَبِيعَةً وَرَبِيعَةً رُدَّ عَلَيَّ مِثْلَهَا حَتَّى يَكُونَ قِصَاصًا. Say the same back to me so we can be even. Say what I said to you, say it back to me so we can be even. فَقُلْتُ I said, لَا وَاللَّهِ لَا أَفْعَلْ. No, but Allah, I can't do it. He then persisted and insisted. I said, I can't say it back to you what you said to me. You know what Abu Bakr did? He said, إِذَا آتِي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. I'm going to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَأَشْكُوا إِلَى. I'm going to complain to him. اِمْتِنَاعَكَ عَنِ الْقِصَاصِ مِنِّي. Your refusal to take your right from me. Look at the scene now. And Abu Bakr storms off and I'm walking behind him. He was worried about the Akhirah. So one day he ate one word. He said, no, I'm going to sort this out. He says, now Abu Bakr is walking urgently. And from a day to finish today, I'm walking after him. And my people now, Banu Aslam, I'm passing by some of them. And they see something is not right. And they come to me, they're walking with me. And I say, what's wrong? And I said, small dilemma. I said, what happened? He said, no, something, and he wants me to take his sauce, but I don't want to take his sauce. So they said, you mean to say he did something wrong, and now he's going to complain? So now he looks at his people, he says, wayhakum, woe to you, atadruna man hadha, do you know who this is? Hadha siddiq, this is a siddiq, the honest one, the truthful one, wa dhu shaymat al-muslimin, and the senior of the muslimun, irja'u qabla an yaltafita fayarakum. Go back before he sees you, and then he may think that you have come to support me against him, فَيَغْضَبْ. And then he becomes angry, and then we come to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then we all become deserving of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's anger because Abu Bakr is angry with us. Go. So they left for Raja'u. Look at their concern about each other, and their character. He says, so now Abu Bakr al-Anbu comes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَحَدَّثَهُ الْحَدِيثُ كَمَا كَانَ. And he conveys to Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam all that happened, like it happened. And the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, through all his while, he's sitting with his head lowered and listening to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. When he was done, رَفَعَ الرَّسُولُ رَأْسَهُ إِلَيَّ. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam raised his head and he looked at me. Now he knows Rabi'ah with all the history, and he knows Abu Bakr, his childhood friend. And Abu Bakr's, we know Abu Bakr's maqam, his state by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He looks at the Rabi'ah and he says, Ya Rabi'ah, ma laka wa li siddiq. It's difficult to translate that. He says, what happened between you and the siddiq? فَقُلْتُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ I said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, minni an aqula lahu kama qala li falam af'al. He wanted me to say to him like he said to me, and I refused. The Prophet said, Na'am, yes, you've done well. La taqul lahu kama qala lak. Don't say to him like he said to you, but you must say something. You can't leave Abu Bakr like that, heavy. Abu Bakr is hard, he's raqeeq. Abu Bakr would cry for anything. And I missed something. He was on the way walking, the Prophet said, Abu Bakr was crying over that word. So Nabi Muhammad says to Rabi'ah, it's good you never repeated the word, but you can't leave him without saying anything. Kullahu, say to him, Ghafarullahu laka ya Abu Bakr, or Ghafarullahu li Abu Bakr. May Allah forgive you, Abu Bakr. So I said to him, Ghafarullahu laka ya Abu Bakr. He says, I said to this Abu Bakr, I said these words to Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Famada wa aynahu tafidani min al-dam. He then left, and his eyes were rolling with tears. And as he's walking, he's saying to me over and over, he's calling out loud, crying, and saying, Jazakallahu anhi khairan ya Rabi'ah, Jazakallahu anhi khairan ya Rabi'ah. May Allah reward you well on my behalf, O Rabi'ah. May Allah reward you well on my behalf, O Rabi'ah. Radiallahu anhu wa Allah. Look at these gems of men. From a man, a young man, who was in his own space there. The moment he realized Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's maqam in this dunya and the maqam that Rasulullah was supposed to have in his life, he went into service to Rasulullah. And the moment he got the opportunity to have the dunya at his feet, at his beck and call, he chose akhirah, and as a result, Allah gave him dunya. Allah gave him dunya in different ways. Allah gave him the wife. Allah gave him the dwelling and property. Allah gave him even an experience that he could not have fathomed. He was from the Ansar, Abu Bakr was from the Muhajirun, and here, and not any from the Muhajirun. Of the best of them, our ulama say that Abu Bakr Siddiq is the best man of the Ummah after the Anbiya. Is it not? He has a situation here where he is in a position where he has to pray for the forgiveness of Abu Bakr, and in turn, Abu Bakr by that dua prays that Allah rewards him. Allah grant us tawfiq to draw from the lessons of the lives of these men. It's one thing to have knowledge regarding something. Knowledge in itself is not really powerful. Knowledge is potential power. Implemented knowledge is power. May Allah make us of those who reflect in these days and make us of those who are strong enough to give preference to the akhirah over this dunya, and as a result, may Allah give us of this dunya as a bonus, because we need dunya too, but as a bonus. The dunya must not enter our hearts. The dunya must not be in our pockets and accounts. The akhirah must be in our hearts and in the foremost of our intentions and all our activities. May Allah make it easy for us. Amin.